Mr. Gergen?
Present.
Mr. Keller?
Here.
Mrs. McLean?
Present.
Mr. Schneider?
Here.
Mr. Sharp?
Here.
Dr. Smith?
Present.
Mrs. Weingarten?
Present.
Please stand and join me in the pledge of allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
And to kill time, we will not sing the anthem. I want to welcome Michael Boyer.
Thank you.
It's good to have you here.
Appreciate it.
Yeah, glad to have you. And welcome our guests. Glad to have a couple folks in the audience at least. You have before you previous minutes from the June 19th regular meeting and then the June 30th special meeting.
I move to approve both sets of minutes.
Second.
Any questions, comments, corrections? Hearing none, roll call please.
Mr. Gergen?
Aye.
Mr. Keller?
Abstain, I was absent for the June 19th.
Mrs. McLean?
Aye.
Mr. Schneider?
Aye.
Mr. Sharp?
Aye.
Dr. Smith?
Aye.
Mrs. Weingarten?
Aye.
Kind of echoey tonight.
It is. The door is open. That's why.
You also have before you tonight's agenda.
Make a motion to approve as presented.
I'll second.
Any questions, comments, corrections? Okay, roll call please.
Mr. Gergen?
Aye.
Mr. Keller?
Aye.
Mrs. McLean?
Aye.
Mr. Schneider?
Aye.
Mr. Sharp?
Aye.
Dr. Smith?
Aye.
Mrs. Weingarten?
Aye.
Special presentations. We are joined tonight by Mrs. Meg Fow. Hello, welcome. And Brian Amack to give a demonstration about our new online registration process, which makes you very popular people in this district because people have been looking for this for a while.
It's been a lot of hard work this summer to get together.
I imagine it probably has.
So this is going to be the starting screen that you'll see. Notice we've got English and Spanish. I'm still kind of tiny hiccups in the Spanish section that we're working through. So as soon as that gets done, we're done. If I go into English, it'll come up here. Again, everything's been translated already. It's just there's a couple of minor little things in the Spanish slide that are not working right. So then.
Which issues that's translated? It's not that simple. Every single word has to be translated every time. We can have multiple languages, but everything has to be translated exactly. And then you have screens, screens, screens. She's being very modest. It's a lot of work to just bring up one language.
Right, so wherever it says start new registration, and then if I click on Spanish, there's one box for the English, and then the Spanish has to go in another box. So everything throughout the entire system has to go box by box, translated across. So back to English, so I can read it. So returning to, I'm going to show you a saved registration. This is actually the new registration side. It's impossible for me to demo as a parent because I'm not a parent in this district, and I wouldn't want to bring up anybody else's individual data. It would not be the right thing to do for. So I'm going to show you my stuff, which is just, I threw in my family and my kid, so, but not real data with anything. And yes, I get to be number one. The biggest problem that people are going to have is this patch right here. I got lucky and got a good one here. Know that an X could be capital or lowercase, and you wouldn't know. V's, W's, O's, zeros, they're all not fun. But there's a refresh button right here. If you keep hitting that, you'll eventually get one that you can easily see. I'm not going to hit that because I can easily see this one. Okay, so then it brings you to the opening screen here. On your home computers, you probably won't have to screen, scroll up and down. On my computer at my desk, I don't have to, but on the laptop, I'm going to have to scroll up and down, so depending on your screen size here. This is telling you what all you need. I bolded the documents that you're gonna need. So proof of residency for a new applicant, immunization records again for a new applicant, and birth certificates, definitely for new, and we're hoping we can get other people to scan them in so that they can be scanned in the system and not just be sitting in the Q files, so. See, this link here takes you to the school's website. And it brings you into the online registration. Green items mean I've completed them. This one, it jumps straight to student and is yellow because I have not finished that. Again, it's, you can save it, come back to it, edit things until you've submitted them. So I'm gonna go back to the very beginning of this. Notice the student's now red because I haven't finished it. So this is your, just home information, your household. As a returning person, the information should be there. You should just look at it and say, yep, that's still my phone number. Click next. Yep, that's still where I live. You can upload a proof of residency. You just click on that button. It should bring you there. You can find your document. If you've got a phone, you can take a picture of it and upload it. So grab my sample utility bill and put that in there. And then if your mailing address is the same, you just leave that checked. If it's not the same, you can come here. It's kind of nice because if I put in a couple of numbers, it starts giving me options of addresses that are already in the system. And then it will fill the whole thing for me. Or if I don't want that one, I just check it and it goes away. Pretty intuitive. If I hit save and continue, it'll take me to the next part. This is the parent information. So you have to, if you're already in the system, both you and your spouse will be there. Or steps and whoever else is considered a guardian there. So you've got your demographics again. Again, most of this is gonna be filled in for you if you're returning. You can check and uncheck boxes as you need. Add secondary emails.
Be careful not to check all those boxes you learned.
Unless you want, yeah, phone call on your home phone call on your work phone, an email. Yes, be selective. There are some things that you're gonna have to fill out that were in those packets. So you'll have to fill out your migrant worker eligibility form, but it should be pretty easy to just check yes or no and ignore the rest or choose the one you want.
That's great. That replaces a lot of paper.
Yes. And you don't have to do one per kid. You've got one for the district. We'll get to the student side in just a second. This is gonna be new. We need to collect and report to the state if people are a member of the military, if as they wanna report it, not necessarily as they actually are. So if you're in the military and you wanna say you're not, you're welcome to do that. And then your work information, Sherman asked to put this on there because they need it for what they're reporting. So if you're not having a child in Sherman, you would just skip the screen. Okay, so then you could add another parent or guardian if you wanted to, in case your family household changed. If not, you can just keep going. So then you've got your emergency contacts. You can have them in the house or you can have them outside of the house. So this one's not in my house. So I have his phone numbers. And since he's not in my house, it doesn't give the whole address thing. It just gives two lines that you type your address in. Everything in here will get saved into the back end of Infinite Campus. So the secretaries could then look this up. And if they wanted to add this address into Infinite Campus, they could. But they wouldn't have to because it would be on a screen, just not searchable. Okay, so there's your emergency contact information. Next thing is your non-household or other household. Less information needed because you already said that this is a household person. So this is the only information you need to say is who is it. And you're just gonna be approving this stuff as you go through. And again, you could add more if you want to. In case an aunt or uncle moves into the household, you need to add them in there. And then you get to the student side. It's yellow again because I'm not complete. I've not done something in here and I did not upload my immunizations. So it's do. It's pretty intuitive. If it's ninth grade, the dropdown only gives you Fort Morgan High School. If you put in third grade, the dropdown gives you those schools. That doesn't necessarily mean that that's where you're going. That's just what you're putting in there and depending on where you live and you know, the whole procedure there. Let's see, this spot for the birth certificate, so I could remove that. I could upload a different birth certificate, so I think I've got a sample one in here somewhere. Or maybe not. That's probably why I have that. So we will just throw my immunization there.
Okay.
Maybe it's not happy with something I've done.
Oh, I didn't pick a school. It's off the edge of my screen here.
It seems to me that the uploading is gonna be the one that snags people. So what will happen if they do all this and they don't have the ability to know how to upload?
They can bring them in.
They can just bring them in.
And the secretaries will have the ability to look at what applications have not been submitted. And you can't submit unless everything required is there. And then they can say, oh, they just needed a birth certificate. I have the birth certificate, and they can push it through. So there's that. Let me put this back to ninth grade. Put this back to Fort Morgan. And now should let me go to next. Nope, and he is not a foreign exchange student. Okay. It's a little helpful hints everywhere. You do have to put in race ethnicity again. It's returning student. It should all be there for you. Housing, this has to be updated every year for the McKinney Bento. These are all the plans. This one only shows up for new students because if you're returning, we already know all of this. So this wouldn't be there for a returning student. Language survey, I believe, only shows up for new students also because again, we already know if your student speaks English or some other language. Previous school should only show up for new students. Tribal information. Right now, I can't find a way to turn it off. There's certain things in here that it wants to have it in the background. We're not reporting this, so we don't really have to have this, but it's gonna be there. This is where you can show who's got guardianship or not guardianship. No relationship removes them from the student. So you might have a person that's in your household and you want them related to this student but not that student because of the way the dynamics of your household work. Again, your emergency contacts, and that was all the information that was entered before, and this is just telling you how you want to contact them, which order the phone call is gonna go out, basically. Primary care, this is information that's gonna go to a special tab in Infinite Campus so that we can pull up the information, be useful for the high school for sports, and middle school for sports. And all the other activities, not just sports. This is where you're gonna put in the medical information, and the nurses have a part of looking at the applications so that you won't have to fill in the medical form. So this goes straight in here. I can add a condition. Now, maybe I've got a bone and joint issue. I can type stuff in here. It hurts. Okay. If I don't want this one anymore because I'm not allergic to stuff anymore, I can remove it and just update the information as you go through. Again, anything that's in Infinite Campus already should be popping up here, and you're just quickly going through and approving all this stuff. Spot for your immunizations. And I can grab that now. And then this is the page for all of those. Yeah, I have a handbook. Yes, they can. You can use a photo. This is kind of a neat one. It's for the students for grade 7 through 12. They can actually sit here and... Yes, I practiced. Ooh, that looks more like a D. Okay. And if you don't like it, you can clear it and try again. And then there's a spot down here for you to actually type your name to say, yeah, this is my electronic signature. And then the last page here on the student is all the information for how he's getting to school, he or she's gonna get to school. And the high school requested to have all the information for their make and model of their car, so they can get that put on their permit sticker thing they've got for the, their cars. And then when you're all done, you can save and continue. And it will only come up and tell you to submit if you have actually finished everything and everything's green at the top, otherwise it will not let you submit. But you can save and come back and finish what you need to come back and save, finish later, or give a call into the office if you need help with anything. You can also print the whole application, so you can have your copy of what you've got.
Questions for me?
At the very beginning, when you bring up the parent information to get into the whole system.
All the way back there?
Yeah, the very beginning. Does it matter, I mean, can you, any parent that's already listed in the household, if you put their name in there, it'll bring up?
As a returning student, you wouldn't be doing this, you'll have a link that puts you right into what you need.
Okay.
This is, again, from the new side, because it's on the demo.
Okay, gotcha.
Sorry.
No, no problem.
Is there still gonna be an option to go into the school and physically register for the parents?
There's still gonna be registration day, there'll be laptops around in kiosk mode like this, so that we can help people get on to their accounts, but yes, there'll also be an option for paper, because there's gonna be some people that they can't do this. We imagine that the first year will be a little bit harder, because there's a lot of people that haven't been using their portal that we're now asking them to use, so. It'll be a problem.
I know it's been a lot of work, but it's gonna be really terrific, and you know, I think once people get used to it, you know, they'll start to learn this is the way to do it.
I'm hoping between having the online registration and having the elementaries now with their standards-based report cards, where they're putting stuff on there, that parents will start using the portal and having really good dialogues with their instructors.
I think it's terrific, thank you very much for all the work you put in. I'm excited, because my last kid is a senior, so I'll get to actually do this one.
Good.
Any other questions? Thank you.
Ryan, did I skip anything?
Oh, it was terrific, it's great to see, thank you very much, and thank you for being here tonight to share it with us.
You're welcome.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Our next presentation will be regarding election this year, which we may have to have. We have three board members who are nearing the end of their term. So Mrs. Temple is going to go through the process, or is there anybody sitting up here or elsewhere?
I'm still updating, so I can't pull anything up.
Yeah, it's still up.
Oh, it just finished. Anyway. So I included a whole bunch of information in your board packet for you. So the seats that are up for reelection this time is Mr. Gerken, Mr. Keller, and Mr. Schneider. You will notice that there's a timeline in there for directors, for school board directors, and then some basic election information. And so this is available to all of you as returning board members, and then this will also be available to the public if anybody comes and requests that I can either email it to them or give them a printed copy of this. Good basic information for them. I included in there the resolution that you will be approving later on tonight that just says you intend to participate in the election. I included the call for nominations, which is also very important. The call for nominations goes in, I believe it's August 9th. Is that right? Okay. And then that means that's the first day that you can take out a petition. And then as electors, you have to have 50 signatures. And then that has to be returned to me, the designated election official, assuming you approve that tonight, before the 24th. And I do have to have time to enter the Secretary of State system for registered voters and verify every signature on your petition. So for those interested in participating in the election. I highly recommend that you either turn in your petition a couple of days early, because if you turn it in and you don't have enough signatures, 50 qualified signatures, then I can call you and say you are minus X number, or just get more to begin with, so, which is also a good idea, no matter what. It's also a good idea to do both of those, just in case. And the things that frequently happen is registered voters will move, and then they'll update all of their addresses, but forget to update their registered voter address, and then that makes them a non-eligible signature on your petition. Or they think they're registered and they're actually not registered. Or those are the two big ones that usually happen. Or they might think they live within the district and they really don't live within the school district. So if you're going to run, I highly recommend that you get started on your petition right away and then get some extras and turn it in early. Now, as a candidate, you can have somebody else circulate the petition for you. However, they do have to come in and fill out a circulator's affidavit, and it does have to be notarized by me. So if you have somebody, a spouse, a friend, or whatever, that you think is going to be circulating a petition for you, then you need to make sure that they get that piece of it filled out. And when you come in and get a petition, you also have to fill out the candidate affidavit and sign it in front of me. So that's the call for nominations. Then I did include the Fair Campaign Practices Act. Typically in school board elections, we don't have campaign fundraising or campaign expenditures, but you do as a candidate still have to fill out that form, and you actually go on to the Secretary of State website and fill it out yourself. And so that just gives you some basic information about the Fair Campaign Practices Act and what you need to do in order to fill out that form. And then I included the school board candidate guide, which is just great information from CASB, and along with that, then the veteran leader to new leader guide, which is actually an updated version of their leader guide. And they just made it a little bit more user-friendly and updated the information in it. So it's also a good point of reference for you for both a veteran candidate and a new person. Is there any questions about the election process? We will only have a candidate election this year. We will not be having a Tabor election. Yay.
If there's
a deadline, and if there are not more than three candidates, then there's a deadline, and we would have a regular board meeting that would fall within that time period. Then we would be able to cancel the election, and at that point, then declare the candidates elected. And that has happened in the past, the last few times. So, not last time, but a couple of times. Oh, was it last time?
Yes.
Okay. All right. And then, and we have
four the year I came in.
Was it?
Four candidates.
I think
there
were five.
For the three spots?
There was five.
What am I forgetting?
George.
And two. Yeah.
Thank you, Karen.
Okay.
We should all that information. Mm-hmm. And anybody who needs to knows where to find you for more information. Thank you. We do have an opportunity for audience.
There's only one me, Melissa. That is true. Gosh, does this really work? Hello. It's okay. I really talk pretty loud. So my name is Lori Jarrell, and I am with the High Plains Research Network, which is through the University of Colorado with the Department of Family.
actually have a grant through the Research Network, and we do a lot of research and quality improvement things throughout all of eastern Colorado. And this grant includes actually the San Luis Valley. And this particular grant actually has two different elements to it. One of them is, and this is what I usually do, I don't usually come talk to school boards, but I will be teaching primary care practices in eastern Colorado about opioid use disorder. And that's the topic that this is about. And talking about some new medications, or newer medications, that are available so that hopefully we can have a lot more treatment options for people who wrestle with this issue. So I'm going to be doing, I'm going to be teaching primary care practices. And then the other element of this grant is a community outreach. And so what we're choosing to do is we've had 12 different leadership groups that we've identified that have said, who are some people in the community that have a good pulse on what's happening within our communities? And so the school board was one of them, county commissioners, we've done service providers, the city council, lots of different people that we've been kind of identifying as people who we might be able to survey. So that's why I'm here, is I'm asking if you would be willing to do a survey. And what it is, it's a short, very short survey, it's just a couple of pages. And essentially what it is, we're just looking at like knowledge and attitudes and just beliefs about what's happening in Fort Warren, in this community, about opioid use and its treatment. And so this is completely confidential, so Melissa, Connie, I don't want you putting your name on it, okay? It's completely confidential, and what happens is this, is that you fill this out, and here's an explanation, here's the actual survey, here's an explanation page, if you'd like that, and all the different approvals that we have to have for this stuff. And then there's a self-addressed stamped envelope, and this just goes back to the university and to all the statisticians and all the people that kind of bring all this together. In a summary form. And so it was a randomization as far as Fort Morgan getting chosen. There are different, we couldn't survey all the towns in eastern Colorado in the San Luis Valley. So Fort Morgan was just one of them that was chosen randomly. So this is completely confidential. You don't get paid for this. And do you have any questions based upon what I've talked about?
What do they do with the information?
So, what we're going to do, actually, with this information is we're going to survey people in the communities before, and then we're going to have a community intervention, and we're kind of working on what that looks like and what that is, and then we're going to be doing a survey afterwards to kind of see what is the difference there. Even with us speaking together earlier, she talked about how she's been hearing more about opioids lately. So we're basically going to go ahead and publish our findings, and we're hoping, this is our hope, because this project is unlike anything else in the U.S., and we're hoping we have developed this practice curriculum, and we're hoping that this will go out to different primary care practices in the U.S. to be able to train them about this medication-assisted treatment and how to help people. Does that answer your question? Anybody else? Any other questions? So, what I'm wondering is, what would work best for you guys? I'm happy to hand this out. Mind you, it's completely voluntary. I don't want to put anybody on the spot if you don't want to do this. I'm happy to leave these here. Also, if you're not on the school board, I'm not sure quite what your capacity is. So, if you're not on the school board and you would like to take one of these, we would love anyone from the community to take these surveys as well. So anytime we go out and give surveys, we're just like, hey, anybody wants to do this, we would love to have your input on this too. So what do you guys, what would you like?
If you leave, either way, but if you want to leave them there, we could grab them on the way out.
Okay, great.
Buy these this way.
So the yellow, essentially, we're color coordinated. There are 7 for school board members, is that right?
Yes.
And then the rest of them, which now I need to, all of a sudden I started counting people.
This is a process where a patient has been prescribed an opioid as far as pain management process and has been in it long enough now. It's an addictive situation and working with the primary care physician to how to treat that addiction. Is that?
Yeah, essentially. That's a great way to explain that. So it could be that generally the person is at least tolerant, if not dependent, if not addicted. So kind of recognizing all of those signs and being able to help identify the person and give them a treatment option. So with this grant, a physician can take some class and then they can prescribe this medication, in which if I'm struggling with opioid use, I can just go see Dr. Smith at the hospital. No, I wouldn't see you for this, but I would go to...
We do.
We need to talk after this. Anyway, so I can go to my primary care doctor, which is where I do a lot of my stuff at, okay? And so people don't think twice about me with my primary care doctor. I don't want to let people know I wrestle with this. Do you understand what I mean by that?
Is this funded at all by pharmaceutical companies?
Oh, no. Oh, what a great question. I've never even thought to say that. No. It's the Area Health and Quality. It's a big government kind of deal, so it has nothing to do with pharmaceuticals. But I never even thought to say that. I'm glad you asked that. Anything else? I think I'll just chat that out the next time I do this to a group. So here's these, and I just appreciate all your time.
Thank you. We appreciate your time. Thanks for coming to talk about this. I know it's a challenge. Okay. Moving on to reports. Does anybody from the board have anything to report on? No. Our superintendent, we may notice, is absent. He's getting probably much needed vacation, and so Rena Frasco is the one in charge this week. Do the short straw, and do you have anything you would like to refer?
Not tonight.
Thank you. Next, we will hand it over to Michael Boyer. I see that we have a vacancy and hire report before us.
You bet. So I'm not looking at that same report, and I apologize, but there are a few folks that we've hired in the most recent past. And their name should be in front of you for your approval. And we do still have some openings in the district, and those are all posted on the website, and we're trying to fill them as time goes along here.
Great. Thank you. Getting closer.
Yep.
Getting closer. Thank you very much. Sorry, I have a lot of things that are still open on here.
I'm just waiting in the ring to spring into action.
Yes, he is.
It says none, but that's not a true statement.
I knew it wouldn't be. Hang on, I've got a lot of pages to close.
Last week it was none.
It says none. We're counting none.
We don't look like none.
All right, Mike, it's your turn.
Another tree bites the dust.
Thank you.
So please, you're reading.
Thank you. Ooh, colors.
That's a little writing. It's not his usual.
Well, this is a fairly easy transition from opioid addiction to unfunded peril.
Mandate?
Pension liability obligation. This was just made available today, so I just kind of want to share with the board. We've had some kind of recent discussions on PARA and kind of what's going on with PARA. Second sentence, the results are credit negative for the state of Colorado and reporting participating local governments, because Moody's adjusted net pension liabilities for PARA rose to $69 billion, an 8% increase over the prior year. This is a continuation of the funding dilemmas that PARA is currently experiencing. We spin to page two. This is actually the demonstrated school division, which is our main focus. The green is what we're actually contributing. And of course, you can see that number ticking up, especially starting more recently in 2010, Senate Bill 1, where we all, as districts, started contributing more. The blue is the projected calculation for the next 2 years as we get fully funded, at least under the current legislative rules. The black is what the actuarial determined contribution should be. So you can see what we're contributing and what we're projected contributing versus what is actuarially calculated, what should be contributed. There's definitely a gap there. And then if you look at a Moody's description of a tread water indicator, that is with contributions at least equaling and not seeing the unfunded obligation increase. So just literally tread water, just to keep your head at the current level of water level, would be projected to be 2017 to 35%, and our funding contribution right now is only 20. So you see the issue at hand. Paris full funding for the school division has now accelerated up to 78 years before we become fully funded. That's moved up from about 38 years. Part of that is they're adjusting their actuary determined their rate of return as they calculate the actuarial obligations. We're all living longer, requiring further longer payments for our pair of retirees. And it's just, it's a tough deal as far as I see it. It's a tough deal. So we'll get our, I actually got the updated numbers from PARA just because they released their annual report. And I'll be giving you what that is this fall when we look at our annual audit report with our liability. We went from 49 million a year ago, 2 years ago, excuse me, to 55 million last June. And it's going to go up from there as to what our piece of that multi-billion dollar liability is, RE3. So I'll just keep you kind of apprised. Paris starting a tour around the strait, around the state, trying to get some dialogue and discussions about what they do. But the concerning comment is the last sentence on the first paragraph. The results also signal that additional government cost increases beyond those already scheduled are highly likely because contributions remain far too low to keep pace with liability growth. So that's sort of translation is that may require, well, it would require legislative action, but that would then trigger potentially an increasing PARA contribution from participating districts. And I don't see how they leave the employee portion of that alone like they did in 2010. That's a perfect point to me. But that would trigger just greater pressure on the general funds in addition to our existing pressures under health insurance. So that's a component of our overall operating costs is definitely under pressure. So you want to go back and talk about opioid addiction?
I'm going to have one.
Yeah. One may be easier to solve than the other. So.
Thank you. Okay. We'll move on to discussion items. You have before you some policies here on first reading. EBBB, accident reports, EBCE, school closings and cancellations, my daughter's favorite. ECA/ECAB, security access to buildings, ECAF, use of video and audio monitoring, ECAF-R, EEAEF, video cameras on transportation vehicles. This is an elimination of this policy as well as the dash R that belongs with that policy. And then there's the IC, ICA, school year, school calendar, instruction time policy. These were all recommended by CASB. Karen, do you want to speak to these? You can probably speak to them better than I can read that.
Sure. What I did forget to put in your packet there is that these eight policies, as well as about 20 more, are all coming to you in the next couple of board meetings, and they are all due to the implications of the Claire Davis Act, all about safety and security and the obligations of school districts within that bill. So the EEAEF, the video cameras on transportation vehicles, as long as the along with the regulation on that, those are being eliminated because those were specifically just about transportation vehicles. So the two that were added, this ECAF and the regulation with that, those are more encompassing of video and audio monitoring in all across the district. So it includes the transportation, but it also includes the buildings and what the regulations are around that. So it just became more encompassing and trying to, you know, not be so scattered in our policies and much more together on everything all in one policy. Then the accident reports there and the security to access and security to the buildings, that's better protected. Those have been updated to better protect the district's interests regarding the safety and security of schools. And they eliminated some of the unnecessary language because it could have been problematic in certain situations, okay? And then the EBCE and the ICICA, you'll notice on the ICICA, that's minimal language changes and some citation updates. And the EBCE, the basic premise with that is that in the past, all school closures had to be ratified by the board. This allows the administration in emergency situations to go ahead and close a school when needed, and that they don't have to rely upon the board to ratify that if it comes down to that, if there's that type of a situation. So it just gives the administration the ability to act in an emergency situation. Okay? So then I will be working on first readings on the next two board meetings of all of the other updates that are coming.
So on the school calendar instruction time, the dates haven't changed on the one minimum 176 to maximum 185. Those are what we've had in
those are currently. What we have had in the past. Now the CASB policy actually does not specifically identify days like our policy does, but several, I don't know, one or two boards previous to you wanted to be sure and have those requirements in there. So there's a minimum amount that we have to meet. That's in there is above the minimum amount. So if the board as a group wants to make the change to that policy, we certainly can look at that.
Okay, thank you. Mm-hmm. Any other questions regarding these first readings of these policies? Okay. Thank you. Mm-hmm. Moving on to the consent agenda, you have personnel action report before you, and there are no claims and accounts tonight.
Move to approve the consent agenda.
Second.
Any questions, comments? Hearing none, roll call please.
Mr. Gerken?
Aye.
Mr. Keller?
Aye.
Mrs. McLean?
Aye.
Mr. Schneider?
Aye.
Mr. Sharp?
Aye.
Dr. Smits?
Aye.
Mrs. Weingarten?
Aye. Next, under action items, action item A is consideration to approve policies upon third reading. We have policies regarding school meal payments, civil rights complaint procedure for the school nutrition program, and then the school nutrition program, free and reduced price food services, nutritious food choices, and healthy beverage standards for schools.
So there are some fill-in-the-blanks there that were not in the last reading. And I did review these policies with Mrs. Tremolin, and we filled in the blanks that were necessary. And Mr. Lee looked at a couple of those as well because he has a part in a couple of those and is the named person on the civil rights complaint procedure, I believe. So all of those blanks have been filled in now, and this is what we currently practice and will be practicing.
Okay.
I move that we approve the policies on the third reading.
Second.
Any further questions or discussion? You'd have to put your name in there, huh?
Well, the odd thing was, is that majority of that is application for free and reduce, and if you don't meet certain income, family size, income thresholds, you're disqualified, or if you don't respond, a lot of it's kind of financial related stuff.
Okay.
And it just kind of made sense for that to come through my office as opposed to someone else's, but it's kind of financially driven.
Okay, works for me. No other questions, then, roll call, please.
Mr. Gerken?
Aye.
Mr. Keller?
Aye.
Mrs. McLean?
Aye.
Mr. Schneider?
Aye.
Mr. Sharp?
Aye.
Dr. Smith?
Aye.
Mrs. Weingarten?
Aye. Action item B is consideration to approve designating an election official for the board election.
I move we approve action item B.
Second.
Any questions? That person is Karen Temple? Okay, roll call, please.
Mr. Gerken?
Aye.
Mr. Keller?
Aye.
Mrs. McLean?
Aye.
Mr. Schneider?
Aye.
Mr. Sharp?
Aye.
Dr. Smith?
Aye.
Mrs. Weingarten?
Aye. I'm sorry, I'm still getting used to this, the way we open all these things now, it's different. Next, action item C, consideration to approve the coordinated election.
I move we approve action item C.
I'll second.
Any questions, comments? Hearing none, roll call, please.
Mr. Gerken?
Aye.
Mr. Keller?
Aye.
Mrs. McLean?
Aye.
Mr. Schneider?
Aye.
Mr. Sharp?
Aye.
Dr. Smith?
Aye.
Mrs. Weingarten?
Aye. And action item D is consideration to approve the call for nominations for school board directors.
Move to approve.
I'll second.
Any questions, comments? Hearing none, roll call, please.
Mr. Gerken?
Aye.
Mr. Keller?
Aye.
Mrs. McLean?
Aye.
Mr. Schneider?
Aye.
Mr. Sharp?
Aye.
Dr. Smith?
Aye.
Mrs. Weingarten?
Aye. Yeah, before you know information items, advanced planning, next regular meeting, August 21st, here at the District Support Center, 7 p.m. The district all-staff meeting will be August 16th at 8 a.m. at Fort Morgan High School. And the first day of school for most students is August 17th, 2017. Anything else for the good of the order?
You know, you mentioned that there's a lot of different things to open up there. We have made a decision about a new board posting packet or program, and so we'll be getting that implemented, and my goal is to have it done by the August 21st meeting. So, look a little bit differently, but I think you guys are gonna like it.
Okay, sounds good. Well, thank you very much, and with that, we will adjourn.
Like a record right there, huh?